Hello and welcome to part 7 of the Stuart Warner Radio Saga. If you remember, at the end of part 6, I asked you guys, the subscribers, to decide what direction this chassis was going to take next in its restoration. And I got one response back from one of my subscribers by the name of Old Radio Al, and he agreed with me. What I think should be the next step, I should say. And that's removing the variable capacitor that does our tuning for the shortwave and broadcast bands for this radio, and to start working on cleaning it up. It is pretty grungy, dirty. There's about 82 years of grime on this thing. It's not bad, is it? So, what methods are out there for cleaning the variable capacitor or other parts of a radio? Well, there's a few methods out there. I mean, one, a guy could disassemble this off of the chassis, put it in the sink, and use hot water and spray it down and scrub it down. You know, being careful, of course, not to damage these very delicate tuning fins. They can be straightened if they're bent, but at all costs, try to avoid nicking these things up if you can absolutely avoid it. There's people that have, one person in particular has an ultrasonic cleaner that he has submerged tuning condensers in and has had very good results with them being cleaned up that way, and they look great when they come out the other side. I don't have one of them at my disposal, but we're going to step it up a notch and we're going to look into the other expert cleaning methods in the radio restoration field that are out there. And I just happen to have one here in my kitchen. What is that? It's called a Whirlpool dishwasher. Now, before I get some hate mail and stuff like that, it is okay and safe to clean radio parts and even chassis inside of a dishwasher. I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't seen it with my own eyes, but it is possible. Now, the next thing of concern, and I always wondered about this, and I looked on the internet, is the caustic action of the detergent on aluminum. Now, we've cleaned a lot of aluminum and stuff in this dishwasher the last 3 or 4 years we've had it, and have had no problems with damage of any kind to any of the saucepans or some of the aluminum cookware we have, aluminum mixing bowls. Everything's come out just fine. And we use the little finish tablet pods, and have never had a problem with anything. Here is what we'll be using for our cleaning via the dishwasher. These work very well. And I looked on Finish's website, and the manufacturer, of course, will tell you what you want to hear, I know. But they show basically anything that's dishwasher safe can be put in your dishwasher and cleaned with these. Now, I don't think that back in 1933 and 34, Stuart Warner even had a clue what a dishwasher was at that point, except for two hands and a washcloth of soap, let alone moving into the 21st century of automation to be able to put anything into a machine and have it automatically scrub it and dry it. So, I mean, you got to use some common sense on some of this stuff, but from what I've learned, there's basically nothing on these chassis short of a transformer, a power transformer, that can't go in your dishwasher and come out the other side clean. If you don't believe me that these can be put in dishwashers, here's this crazy guy out in Arkansas who put a radio chassis in a dishwasher and cleaned it up, and here's his take on it.
What's the worst that can happen? The radio doesn't work when I get done? It doesn't work now.
Exactly. So let's get this thing down in the shop and get the wires unsoldered that go down to the coils and stuff. And get this thing ready for a date with the dishwasher. Alrighty then, the next question is, what do we have to remove to take this tuning capacitor off of our chassis? Well, we have three wires. This goes to the first gang of our tuning condenser. It leads down to one of the coils. This wire here is on our second gang, third gang, I should say, of our tuning condenser, which leads to our band switch, which selects between shortwave and broadcast. And all the way back down in here, this guy right here comes through just right there on the other side of this capacitor, comes to our other coil. Now, I'd have to look at the schematic to know which one is shortwave and which one's broadcast. I'm not exactly sure. So we have to remove all three of those wires from the bottom of the tuning condenser. I'm not going to mess with these coils. I'm going to try to get by not touching either the soldering iron unless I absolutely have to, which in some cases I might, because we have some of these old domino capacitors in here that I'll have to test, and they're more than likely junk. And we've got a few resistors that connect in here and there that I might have to take loose and also get out of the way. And once we get those wires out of the way, we got to take loose these two screws and this screw right here, which is a grounding point in our radio chassis. And then our tuning condenser should pull off of there. Now, there's two other wires that are not associated with the tuning section of this variable capacitor, but they're actually these two wires right here. And where do they go to? They lead up here to our dial lamp. Now I'm going to look to see if there's a way to take that off of there and disassemble that socket. It's pretty tore up right now. It's going to need some work. It was broke when I got the radio. And I will probably try to figure out a way to disconnect this right here and get that off of there, because I don't want that to go. I mean, it wouldn't hurt nothing, but I don't want that to go through the dishwasher. So we got those five wires to get out of the way and 3 volts, and then we've also got to turn our attention upon reassembly to the grommets that are in the chassis, being they're super duper rock hard thanks to years and years of age. And eventually that leads to the looseness on the chassis of the tuning condenser. Actually, that thing pretty much broke on his own. So, hey, looky there, that was easy. Looks to me like what happened I'm not exactly sure what did happen. Oh, there's the back side of the socket, and that center stub broke off. Now, that's no big deal. We can fix that. But it's one less amount, one less job I got to do with the soldering iron, that's for sure. So, let's get down to brass tacks and get that tuning condenser removed from that chassis. Oh no, now I've done it. There ain't no going back now. I've really broke this thing. Her tuning capacitor is now off. It really isn't real bad shape, but I know we can brighten it up and make it look a lot better than what it does. And it's kind of neat, that screwdriver, it's kind of neat how this thing attaches and or floats on the chassis. Now, at one point in this thing's life, these grommets were rubber and they were very pliable. Now, that's not really the case anymore. Now, like I said, it attaches here, here, and here with our three wires coming up. This one comes from a coil. This one comes from a coil. And this one here comes from our band switch right here. And once the rubber grommet is attached into the chassis, it has a spacer. Looks like that guy right there. That goes down through that grommet. And on the underside is a flat washer, a lock washer, and of course the bolt head. And the bottom of the tuning capacitor is threaded. They're right there above my pinky fingers, one of the connection points. And it basically just floats on the chassis. Pretty neat stuff. So we'll have to get these grommets. That shouldn't be a problem. I know of a place it's been mentioned quite regularly here on several of these videos of renovated radios. They probably have what we need. And we're going to have to also find this rubber bushing right here. See, supposedly the way this thing works is when you turn that, and if this thing was the proper size it should be, like it was back in the day, what it does is as you're turning the tuning knob, that rubber turns with it, and it contacts these teeth. And what the teeth do, once they're contacted by the rubber wheel, is open up the plates on our variable capacitor. So, I've got a lead on that too. I know where to get that. This is the thing I haven't figured out yet, what I'm going to do with. I've never seen one of these chassis. They put these chassis not only in this particular console, but Stuart Warner also made a table radio with this R110 chassis. And if anybody can give me an idea of what this guy's supposed to look like I said, he's not very big. Shoot me an email or leave me a message here on the YouTube, and we'll see if we get a new dial scale ordered up. We're a ways from needing that yet. That's not an important issue, but just something I want to touch on. So let's get this dirty little piggy in the dishwasher and get him going and get him cleaned up. Okay, the tuner is in the pot, so to speak. And I also figured while I've got it going through today, I'll throw these three tube shields in that go on this radio too. These go over our number 58 tubes for shielding. And they're steel. They shouldn't be bothered. They just need a good scrubbing too. So, bye-bye. We'll put our packet in here. Make sure everything else is good to go. Now, this dishwasher has the option of a high temp wash. I'm not going to use that today. We're just going to go through our normal cycle with a heated dry. Oh no, there's no going back now. In the meantime, while our tuner is getting scrubbed, we can work on cleaning this chassis. I love the way a clean chassis looks when somebody's went through there and got rid of all this grime and sludge. And these things are gorgeous. They're like chrome when they're polished up. The chassis, this particular one, I think I'm going to do a wipe down with a wet cloth. And then if it still has some staining, I might try some navel jelly in spots and see if we can get it down to clean metal again. I don't expect it to be perfect. You know, I don't want this to be perfect. I don't want it to look like it just rolled off the showroom floor like some of these people do. But, you know, everybody's different when it comes to doing these. Now, the one thing that does I have some concern about, again, which shouldn't be no concerns, I understand. We've got a couple stickers on the back of this. This one here shows the tube locations. This one here, I believe, at one time probably told the model of this particular unit. And we had something right there in that red looks like a stamp. We have a RMA label I'd like to preserve from the Radio Engineering Institute. And on this side, I still have this one. This was a patent sticker. And believe it or not, this had a lot of RCA patents on it, which I know RCA held a lot of patents for these radios in the beginning. But two, this set also has a lot of RCA Radiotron and Cunningham tubes in this. So I think that this thing must have took a something happened to it early in its life, because the tubes that I pulled, some of them have stickers on them that are relevant of about 3 to 5 years after this thing was manufactured and being replaced. And actually it was serviced in Northern Ohio, and not too far from me, a couple hours probably. So I don't know what happened to this thing. There's some soldering work that's been done naturally over the years. One of these, I forget which one it was date coded in the 70s. It's this one here. Let's turn this around and look at it. It's dated 3 of 1970. And this guy over here has a 1963 date code on. Anyway, as I was saying, before I was so rudely cut off by a full memory card once more, this capacitor can dated 1970. This one here, it looks like they cut the base off of the original electrolytic and put a smaller can on top of that. It's dated the fourth week of 1963. Which, these should be 8 microfarads apiece. And there's another little box capacitor under the chassis. I'm nervous, I don't know what's going to happen. Hopefully my tuning capacitor don't get 8 while it's in there. I hear it screaming, don't you? Help! A little bit of elbow grease has yielded very nice results so far. There's a little bit of pitting in this radio chassis, but it isn't real bad. I think that the naval jelly will take care of a lot of that and clean it up. But this is what it looked like before, and this is just wiping it down with a wet soapy rag. And we'll clean up everything just a little bit more. We'll run the naval jelly over the tube sockets and stuff, because that's okay to do. Just don't get it down in there and get into everything. Same thing applies with the holes in the chassis, from what I've been told. Don't slop it all around the place and get it underneath of there. We're not worried about really cleaning the underside right now, which we'll have to do a little bit of cleaning underneath, you know, in spots. It's kind of grungy, but we're primarily focusing on the top while our tuner is being cleaned. After a quick down and dirty cleaning, that chassis looks pretty good. And you know what? The more I scrubbed away, the more excited I got. Because you know, I wasn't only removing exactly 80 years this year worth of dirt and patina, which by the way is worth a lot on eBay. The more I cleaned, the more excited I got. You know, I'm looking at this, it's looking good, you know, I'm cleaning this. These tube sockets are beautiful, they're cleaning up, they're nice and shiny. I'm going to have to polish them out, or not polish them out. The naval jelly will clean them up a little bit more than that. But the more I cleaned, boy oh boy, the more excited I got. And, you know, I never felt that before doing one of these radios, because this is actually the first one I'm doing that is basically a teardown, you know. Stuff's getting rebuilt that needs attention, and the things are being done that this radio needs to be put back into service again, because I have plans for this one. This one's not going to stay with me. I've been thinking about what I'm going to do with it, and it's going to go to a family member when I'm done with it. But you know, that'll be next year sometime, probably, or maybe even late this year. Hard to tell. Let's not make a rash decision right now. Look at how these cans cleaned up. How grungy and dirty them. Oh man, it's just exciting. I love it. Yeah, I know. What a nerd. But I enjoy doing this for that reason. The satisfaction of seeing in the end what your products, you know, this is just a glimpse right now what our product's going to look like when we're done. Can't wait. What I'm doing is some trial and error, because I want to see exactly what will help clean this the best without having to go out and buy some extra stuff I don't need sitting on the shelf that will eventually go bad and I won't need. In this corner, we have our rust remover, our naval jelly, and a little bit left over from that Sylvania cleaning I did on the chassis back a few months ago last year. In this corner, we have Brasso. Which, by the way, do not get that on these cans. Don't do it. Don't even think about it. It'll adversely affect them, and I don't know what it will do to them, but I don't want to try it. And lastly, in this corner, we have Turtle Wax Chrome Polish, which that has been applied to this IF can right here, or coil can. We've applied naval jelly here, And down here in this gummy, nasty looking area, it's got like varnish on it. And up front here, we've tried the Brasso product right in here. And on our brass stem of our tone switch. Which, by the way, I think is the only switch of this set that's besides the band switch. These two switches are original. Somebody's replaced this volume pot at one time. That's a Mallory 500K wire wound control. Pretty high-end control from what I understand, so let's hope that that's good. Now we just sit back and wait and see what does the job the best. Like I said, this is just trial and error. And you can see in here, this is our little Q-tip control area. This was the navel jelly. Look at the schmutz at the end of that Q-tip. The middle one's the Brasso. That got a little bit of crap off of there. And lastly, that's the chrome polish, and the darkness that's on that Q-tip come off of this can cover right here, foil cover, which was it looked like this to begin with. It was fairly clean, I thought, but looks are deceiving. Stand by. I'll give you results here at the end of the video. The results are in for the various products I was trying on this chassis. Here's what the chrome polish did to that can. Boy, it really brightened and sparkled it right up. It's not all greasy feeling like it was. It turned out very nice compared to that one behind it. Look how dull that is. Chrome polish is definitely in for cleaning the cans. Our Brasso brightened up the area but did nothing else other than that. It was just a trial and error. I didn't think it'd do a whole lot. It did, however, clean the grunge off of this tone control stem, so we keep it around for that. The navel jelly did this bit of work right here. Kind of brightened up this area just a little bit. The biggest result was over here. Before, it had this kind of goopy looking sticky varnishy crap. Took that right off. So it looks like our two contenders for the cleaning of this chassis is going to be in this corner, chrome polish. And in this corner, navel jelly. Here's the problem I've noticed with radio restoration so far. Once you start, it's hard to give up and stop. The more I clean on this thing, the more excited, like I said before, I get. So now we're just working on navel jelly in the chassis and spots. I was given a tip to apply this with a Q-tip, that it's a lot easier to control. And that's right, it is. So this has been sitting for a few minutes now, and we'll give it another 5 minutes or so, and then we'll wipe it off and see what we have. I've moved on to the back side of the radio chassis. This was the first coat of navel jelly to the front, and it's working rather well. Now we're on to the back half. I just dug out my AM transmitter and hooked it up here in the kitchen. We're just listening to old music. Oh, I was sitting here attacking the end of this radio chassis with my navel jelly, and results are good. I've basically gotten from here over done, and it's cleaning up really well. And while I was sitting here, I heard a couple clicks, and lo and behold, I think our variable capacitor is done. Not sanitized, but it's done. It's clean. So, see what we got here. Well, it didn't melt, so that's good. Tube shields come out looking really good. They're going to need cleaned a little bit farther. As you can see, they've got some chalky oxidation on them. But it's a good start. They cleaned them up pretty well. Nothing the little navel jelly won't take care of again. They cleaned up really well. Here's what we're after. Well, it looks a lot better. Still kind of oxidized, but the fins are clean now. So, phase one in the cleaning of the tuner is complete as far as I'm concerned. Some light over here. And it looks really good. Should have freed everything up nice. It moved pretty good before, but boy, it's really, really loose now. So, I'll let this thing chill out and dry. Really brightened that up. It's not near as dingy as it was. Pretty good. So guys, I think that does it for this time. For part 7. Hope y'all enjoyed this video, and y'all come back. There'll be more. Thanks for watching.